We will do our best as we speak to introduce ourselves. I'm Stephanie Coe, and we will go ahead and get the meeting started, starting with approval of the minutes. We have two sets of minutes to approve from January 12th and January 20th. Has everyone had a chance to review those? Any comments or concerns about the minutes? Could I have a motion to approve those? Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Thank you. Oh, thank you, Mr. Bells. We will move on to a summary of the public comments that we've received to date. Stephanie, any new comments to add?
So since our January 20th meeting, we did receive five comments. They're included in the manila folder in front of you, the summary, and then the hard copies as well. They'll be posted online to the website in a digital format later this afternoon.
Thank you. We're going to in part skip item number four because I think it is basically part of item number five. So we're going to move on to a discussion of the draft language. So all members of the committee should have received, and I confirmed before the meeting that everyone had a copy of the draft language and had a chance to review that. So basically what I would like to do is go through the draft language in each part that, for lack of a better term, would basically require a vote. We'll go through each part, spend as much time as we need to on each section, and then hopefully take a vote for or against that language, and then move on to the next part as we go through this process. So obviously, if there's any questions, follow-up we need from staff, clarification, they do have the language on the screen, so if there are minor revisions that need to be made while we sit here, we can do that as well. So what I would like to do as we go through each of these topics is kind of start at one end and just go through and give everyone a chance to talk about what they like, dislike, think about each part of the comments, the draft language, I should say, and any comments they have relative to that. And once we've concluded any discussions about that section, like I said, we'll take a vote and then move on to the next section. So starting with the beginning, we have council size and structure, section, I think it's 3 through 19. I want to break this into two parts. So we're going to cover items number 1 and 2, all of the subparts that go with item number 2. We'll consider that, and then we'll come back and consider item number 3 separately. So if that makes sense, we're going to go ahead and get started. And again, as you start to make your comments, if you could just say your name so that the those watching at home can have a better idea of who's speaking. So Lourdes, we're going to start with you, and we'll go this way.
I'm just saying my name? Or
no, just, yes, say your name. But also kind of your thoughts on items 1 and 2 of the council size and structure. We're going to start with just 1 and 2, so not 3 or anything else at this point.
Okay. Lourdes Broso de Padilla, and at this time I do not have comments, but I might after hearing other comments on the sections.
Okay, perfect. Don, I'm going to move on to you.
Okay, John Rosenberger. Well, compliments to staff. It was sort of embryonic what we talked about, and this has ripened nicely. I would say that to you. When we draw big, complicated legal documents, we often, if they're well drafted, there's a provision about whether or not these items are separable. In other words, if you take one thing out of the middle of the contract, does that mean the whole contract goes away, or does it survive? And this notion of expanding the size of a council and the adoption of the district at large, in my view, are inseparable. They both got to happen, and we need to say so, if in fact we feel that way. And there may be some division of opinion, and I respect that whole process, but I do have that single comment that these need to be inseparable, and each is dependent upon the other.
Thank you.
I was paying attention. Were you saying to only speak about this one and what did
yes,
you
say? Yes, 1 and 2, and 2 has sections A through F.
Okay. I agree with John about keeping them together. And that's basically all the comments that I have on 1 and 2.
Okay. Mr. Mills? We might still be on mute. We can't hear you yet.
I was still on mute. You probably will not be shocked that as I stated from the beginning, when we talk about expanding size, I would only be for that if we elected by districts. This is a very unique proposal, and I told you all that when last we met. I think it's something I had never thought of before, but without going to some sort of ward election, district election, not at large by city, I will not be able to support it. I, as a fallback position, also agree with John that if you are in fact going to recommend one, it has to be a part of two as well. But in general, I am not in favor of number two because or number one at this point.
I understand. And I think what I would add is I would agree that I think one and two should be connected. And how we exactly say that, I think we can have a quick conversation here about. And that's my take, that as we've gone through these discussions, they seem very connected to me. The second part I would say is I struggled a little bit, and I thought you were going to go down this path, John, a little bit with how much more do we need to say about this and being very detailed and very specific and really thinking, as I thought through this, that we need to be pretty simple, because I think it's city council's responsibility and ultimately obligation to take a recommendation like this and flesh it out. And I'm kind of getting to point three a little bit, but I see that we should give them sort of the high level guidance or a high level opinion that we took out of this, and then give them the responsibility to figure out what that means specifically. So that was kind of my take. So I'm very supportive of the language as drafted. I would agree that we connect items one and two as part of our recommendation. And I definitely understand Mr. Mills' position, and I think he's been very clear about that from the beginning. Did you want to add something, John?
John Rosenberger again. Thank you, Stephanie, for cracking the door. I assume there's a context that goes with this, some preamble. Mm-hmm. The people just spoke.
Yes.
That counts. And I've said this before, people may not agree. There's not been a change in facts and circumstances that would, I think, gives us license to go to a different conclusion. I feel like our charge is to drill down into this alternative and identify those things where there seem to be some interest. A lack of familiarity by people on city council, because it's a big place. And I think we all, I think maybe that's sort of right. And then there was a sense that there wasn't accountability, and accountability can be accomplished by having your very own city council person that only you can vote on, but also accountability can perhaps be improved by simply having somebody who is from your neighborhood. And if nothing else, there's an emotional engagement between the neighborhood and that fellow resident. I think those things need to be said, because I think that gives us standing to have an opinion that's a bit different from what just got asked and answered. So I this is just a question, frankly, Madam Chair. In fact, there is, I assume, a preamble that goes and surrounds this whole thing. Is that right?
I believe so. We've talked about it sort of as a cover letter or kind of a summary of the work we've done. So, yes, I would say that's true. Okay. I'd like to get through the specific recommendations.
Absolutely.
And then get to the language that we want to surround it with. So, Lourdes, anything you wanted to add after we kind of went around?
I don't believe so. I mean, I guess I want to get into the conversation of how, of connecting these two. Uh-huh. And how that's connected. Mm-hmm. So if we're moving in that direction.
I assume from that comment you're supportive of the two being connected?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So looking to staff here, do we just need to maybe add a sentence, or how would you suggest we make clear that our recommendations for item one include item two and item two include item one?
Chair Coe, members of the committee, just to scratch out something here for your consideration, after the word members under number one, comma, subject to the approval or the adoption of number two. And then under number two, after the word whereby, comma, subject to the adoption of number one.
Okay. Yes.
I had to think about this. But, I go back to why we're here. We're here to respond to the people because there's something that's missing. And I like this proposal because it builds on what we have. We're not losing all the avenues that people have to connect with the city. That was important to me. I was concerned that that one ward would disconnect and make that one ward, you know, the power structure. This, I think, is unique. And when we get to number three, I think it's important for council to really have this explained to the community if they move forward with this. But I also think that it's unique in that it follows through with what Columbus has been. When we looked at all the other cities, best practices, we found cases where things were just a little different because they were addressing the specific needs of their community. And I think that's what we're doing here, because Columbus has had years of at-large elections. And people have liked that. And they voted on that, but was this the fourth time? Third time in August. Was that the third? The third time. And this keeps that spirit and keeps that ability for the citizens to continue to vote and give them that geographic preference that some people have spoken about. And we're only going to know if we put it to a vote. The guiding factor for me was we're not going to know until we ask the people.
Agreed. Thank you. Any other comments on that?
No, I would agree. I think that it is a good compromise. I think that I have found by being a lifelong citizen, even though I've been a boomeranger, that change, it's difficult to sometimes embrace change. I think that there have definitely been two sides to this coin of people who want change, people who like the way that things are, and I think that this is a good compromise to help to meet the needs of people who like the way things are and embrace the spirit of the way things are, but then also the people that want to gently shift us into change. So that I think that it meets the needs of having someone who does represent you, right? We try that, to your point, Jeanette, I think, you know, people can respond to this, we try that. And then if in the future we want to move more in that direction, we're doing that, we're doing it in a way that feels like we are trying to be progressive, we're trying to move forward, and we are listening to everyone's concerns.
I think so too. So I think first I want to make a motion to amend the draft language in items 1 and 2 to add the language Brian read a few minutes ago. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.
Thank you. And then I don't know if I need to make a motion to leave the vote open to allow other members to vote, so, or just say that. Someone clarify?
I think you can just leave the roll open as the chair.
So I'm going to leave the vote open, though, to allow the additional members who may be able to join us in a few minutes to have their vote as well. So with that amended language, I make a motion to support items 1 and 2 of the draft language with the amended language we just approved. Is there a second to that motion?
Let me just see that.
You just amended the language. You didn't
Thank
support
you.
The recommendation.
Thank you for the clarification.
I was thinking I did it twice, so sorry. Okay. So we amended the language with the additions that Brian read a few minutes ago. We just passed that, and now I'm asking that we support items 1 and 2 as amended.
Oh, okay.
So all those, is there a second to that?
Second to that.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed?
Aye.
Thank you. Okay, and again.
It's Fred Mills, by the way.
Thank you, Mr. Mills. And again, we will leave this vote open in case additional members join us, as Carrie has just joined us. So, well, we're just trying to keep you on your toes. Okay. We're going to move on to item number 3 as part of size and structure. I'm going to take a little pause here to reiterate kind of what we're doing. So, number 1, before you speak, if you could say your name. So we're trying to help our audience better know who's speaking. Mr. Mills is on the telephone. I don't believe Pastor Laws has joined us on the phone yet. And what we're doing is, hopefully you've received a copy of the draft language. We're going through the draft language, one sort of set of items or items at a time. We're going to go around the table sort of and have any comments, questions, concerns about each section, then vote for or against that language and kind of move on through the process. So far we've covered items 1 and 2 together, and the vote was taken to amend items 1 and 2. Brian, do you want to read that again just for clarification purposes, or is it up there?
It's up there.
My eyesight is bad, so.
So's mine, so I'll rely on someone younger to.
So the amendment basically changed number 1 to read, expand the size of Columbus City Council from 7 members to 9, and then the amendment is, comma, subject to the adoption of recommendation number 2. The other part of the amendment is in number 2, adopt a district at large form of council whereby, comma, and this is where the amendment starts, subject to the adoption of recommendation number 1. So it ties those two recommendations together.
So this time we voted to, I made a motion to support, to make that amendment and then to support items 1 and 2. And we left the vote open. So if you want to weigh in on that, you can. If you want to wait till later, we can do that too.
I'm supportive of the changes and the amendments.
Fantastic. So we'll consider that a supportive vote. Okay, so now we're moving on to item 3 separately. Lourdes, I'm going to put you on the spot each time, so we're going to start at that end, because I'll get confused if I go the other way. So again, at this point, we're considering item number 3. So we're looking for any questions, concerns, comments, if you need staff to further clarify the language or any of the topics we've covered. That's kind of where we're at. So anything you would like to add?
So I think this was probably, was this discussed, I think, in our last meeting? Okay, great. So if we could talk about it for just a second, since I was not at our last meeting. So when we talk about council actively engaging the community to determine best practices, what does that mean?
Chair Coe, committee member Barroso de Padilla, during the presentation, we wanted to emphasize that in districting, there tends to be a series of best practices around the country that have been recognized by various organizations, which include groups like, excuse me, I'm going through my presentation. Fair Vote, the Brennan Center for Justice at the New York University School of Law, the Congressional Research Service, Ballotpedia, and Loyola Law School in Los Angeles. And so these were things like, you should redistrict after a federal census because you have the most up-to-date population information. Districts should be roughly of equal population size. You should protect racial and language minorities against vote dilution. You cannot favor one political party over another. Districts should be compact, they should be contiguous, they should maintain communities of interest. And so that was kind of that, those were some of those best practices that we were presenting for the council or for the committee's information to say, if you go down this route, these are some of the things that have been recognized as a good way to do this process.
So when we talked about actively engaging the community, what was the process for actively engaging the community?
I think the idea was that we wouldn't necessarily dictate what that was, kind of to the comments I was making before, but to give council the recommendation that we think they need to find a way to engage the community and what this ultimately looks like. So whether they do that by committees, whether they do that by neighborhood meetings, you know, whether I don't think we were sort of getting.
The process was, these are our recommendations, talk to the community, see how they feel, get input, and then allow for a timeline to then implement them.
Right, and sort of to avoid saying do it by this date, but to allow council sort of the.
To figure out
the best way of setting it up for Columbus and, you know, kind of this transitional idea that we've kind of talked about. I mean, there was just a vote, but yet these things do take time, so letting council sort of work through what that timeline looks like versus us trying to dictate what that would look like.
Got it.
Any additional comments about that section or questions?
Not this time. I'm a processor, and so I'm good at processing during conversation
we will come
to
back.
Be deliberate in my responses.
Fantastic. Carrie.
Just a question about the apportionment process. I think it makes sense to not be too specific and give council, you know, the ability to kind of lay out some of the parameters within this recommendation, but just more of a question around the apportionment process. Are there, or have you looked at, I guess my question is just, you know, is there a standard way to do this for a municipal districting? Is it fairly commonplace? Do you have any sense of, or is it like the state process, which it can range very widely?
Typically, I mean, there are fairly common ones, legislative districting, whereby the actual legislative body itself draws the lines based on the information. There are citizens commissions that do that, so groups that are appointed by one mechanism or another to draw the lines based on publicly available information. And so it's based on the presentation from last week, legislative districting has kind of been the default throughout the country, and so that system tends to prevail most just because that's the way it's always been done. But there is a, I don't want to say a concerted push, but there is a certain push to say, you know, citizens commissions are the way that folks are going. If they're introducing it or if they're changing their system, they tend to go to a citizens commission.
Chair Coe, members of the committee, if I could add, because I think Edward's correct about that. The one thing that I would add to the Citizens Commission, even in places that have moved to that, there's typically still a recommendation to the legislative body so that elected officials are still making that final determination. It could vary from preventing a series of maps to the committee or to the legislative body, and the legislative body is unable to change that map. They simply have to vote yes to one of them. Some allow the legislative body to make changes to the map to meet things like Voting Rights Act requirements, but it is exceedingly rare for there to be a citizens commission that both draws the maps and approves them. That very rarely happens.
Thanks.
Okay, any other comments at this point?
I have no suggestions with respect to language. Want to follow up on that response a little bit. Do you believe the reference to best practices picks up this notion of citizens-based apportionment subject to legislative approval is emerged as a best practice? Would you go that far?
I would say that in terms of what's happening across the country, this is appearing to be a preferred method. I'll use that term.
I sense that if the apportionment process was purely legislative here, there'd be disappointment, like we left an opportunity on the table. And so I'm just trying to figure out whether or not the best practices language gets us where I think Carrie is suggesting that it ought to be driven by a citizen process that's then sent on to the legislative body for either correction because of some legality. I'm looking for comfort from council, from our staff, if you will, that in fact this reference to best practices gets the job done.
Chair Coe, members of the committee, I would concur with Edward that a citizen involvement in drawing the maps is definitely a preferred best practice. I would agree emerging best practice would be the best way to couch that. And that can range from citizens being able to submit maps to a legislative body for consideration all the way to a appointed commission of citizens that would draw these maps. I think that would clearly be captured in the current language here.
I just want to repeat that. So you believe it is captured in the language
I
as already
with
written?
Edward, that it is captured in this language.
Are we all generally comfortable with that?
Yeah. Yes. I mean, I think my question really arose out of the complexity of of the appointment process and the structure of some of these, of some citizen commissions to do this, you can tend to get mired in complexity of who can serve, who can't. And, you know, that's a lot to leave wide open for the council. So that was really the nature of my question, is just, you know, if there was some, you know, consensus on how municipal redistricting is done, something I'm not familiar with, more familiar with congressional and state. And I really don't have a strong opinion either way. I just would like to avoid, if we can, contentiousness with the line drawing process, because that, having been in the middle of a very contentious redistricting process myself, can be unpleasant. So that was my that was the nature of my question.
And I mean, to me, item number three, sort of the underlying focus is community involvement. I mean, so I would, my take is that it's included in that, in the sense that we really are looking to council here to actively engage with the community at large to figure out what's best. You know, I would be open to potentially modifying that language. I wouldn't want to go as far as defining you should use this process. I think that has to be left for council to decide after the community involvement and after that. But yeah, Jeanette or John?
Well, Madam Chair, if we were going to add just a word or two, we talk about, especially in the topics of citizen participation in apportionment and reapportionment, and then let the details be handled someplace else. But that would be a nod in that direction without too much work.
I like that a lot.
I like that too.
Can someone type onto that computer screen and make it say that? That was my scientific answer. Jeanette, what do you think?
I would like to see very specific language regarding input on this process. And my reasons are that this would be the first change in our charter in 100 years, I think. And we know best practices, and it's just been discussed here, best practices, but I would just like to give the direction to council to ensure that there is adequate opportunity for the citizens to see, review, and comment on the proposal.
Okay.
And I know we're not, I'm not trying to direct the apportionment process. I agree with Carrie that we don't want it contentious and, you know, spend 6 months trying to figure out who's going to be on the committee and all of that. But I just feel a sense of making sure that for the public, that they have ample opportunity to understand what this is, to digest this, and comment on it. Meaning, not a week, you know, not a presentation at council 1 week and a vote the next. That's what I'm getting at. And I don't know how the wording is, other than to say that we encourage, you know, I would like something a little more specific than engage the community, to just to say to allow adequate time for the public to review and comment on the proposal.
Yeah, I like the phrase, I'm sorry, to review, allow adequate time to review and comment on specific proposals. Kind of almost two parts, kind of what I'm hearing. Like, initially I would assume council would get community input for just doing this in general and what that would look like. But then when there's actually a specific, here's the language we want to use, or here's the process, the apportionment process we want to use, that would then have community input, is that?
I think so. Other cities, you know, they've actually presented, you know, competing maps and let people, they've had them online. I'm just saying, just to make sure that we give ample opportunity for people to know what's going on. That's, I'm not trying to get into the minutiae of how council does it. I just would like to make sure that they understand that we think the citizens' review and comment period is important.
And
that's it in a nutshell.
I would assume all of us probably agree with that. I don't think anyone's going to disagree with that. So can you guys help us with some language?
Just a possible suggestion would be possibly recommending a minimum number of public meetings on a proposed map.
Yeah.
I didn't want to go that far, because I think that's up to council and how they structure it. You know, I'm not trying to be that directive, you know, because say a number of meetings, depending on the structure, that may not work. I don't want to be that specific. I guess I want to put the spirit that we know that this is an important transition, or this will be an important transition for the citizens of Columbus, and to give them the opportunity to review and the comment.
Could we just say that there will be community meetings? And then maybe, I mean, I really liked in this process that people could submit things on the internet and not have to necessarily come down to a meeting if it conflicted with work or whatever. So, I mean, could we say something like that, that the materials will be available for...
Just the opportunity to review and comment, however that may be. Yeah. I mean, you know...
Meetings, could, internet...
You know, the map can be online, or, yeah, or, you know, they'll have comment periods or whatever. It's some of the things that you said, Brian.
Yeah.
But I'm just specifically that from this body, yeah, that we are telling the council that it is very important to have that community input. That's all I'm trying to say. Yeah. I'm not trying to micromanage and how many meetings and what type of meetings,
yeah,
because this is a new process, uh-huh, and they're going to have to work it through.
I believe the solution may be taking the couple three words I offered up and tagging a couple three more words on that about opportunity. I don't have the precise words, but I think that's the piece of this.
To review and comment.
Start of the solution.
Drafting going on.
Oh.
Maybe. I can't see the screen, or I'd be able to.
Yeah, they may have hearings. They may.
Yeah, exactly. I don't want to.
Yeah, so I don't want to.
I don't want to dictate two hearings.
Yes.
Three, there may need to be,
yeah,
five, four. I don't know.
Yeah. Yeah. But I just want.
Yeah. Oh, I apologize, Mr. Mills. I forgot to ask for your comments. And you might still be on mute.
Yes, I am.
Okay.
And most of you probably wish I would stay on mute.
No.
I quite frankly don't have a lot of problems with the language that we're discussing at all. I like the Rosenberger three or four word amendments and would be supportive.
Okay. Any additional comments from anybody as we give staff a few minutes to tweak the language? And I guess I would just echo kind of what's already been said, that I think there has to be substantive community education and opportunities, or either way of this, it ends up being the wrong message. So, you know, whichever position you feel about this topic, if the facts aren't getting out there and the community's not given a chance to see it, there will be great confusion. So I think however council can ultimately flesh out what I'm guessing will be multiple methods of communication with the community that will be needed. I'm sure there will be, you know, one method doesn't work for everyone, I guess is what I'm saying. So making sure that those messages get shared with civic groups and area commissions and, you know, people whose first language may not be English. I mean, I think we need to make sure that we're addressing a variety of topics here. And I think that's where the timeline part plays in for me, that we need to give council time to be able to do that and not dictate, make this happen by August or make this happen by 2018 or something, because I think this is a huge change, to your point, to even pursue this option is not something we've done often. So the community will have to have a first opportunity sort of to take a look at this, or a first new opportunity maybe is a better way of saying that. Mm-hmm. Do you guys have drafted language, or do we need to give you a few more minutes?
We could just have a minute. I think we're getting close to capturing what the committee's looking for.
We will take a pause for a
this
minute.
This is exciting. Waiting to see what comes on the screen.
If only I had better eyesight, I could already see what they were doing.
Yeah, I just gave up trying to read that.
Things keep moving. Remember, we have Nutri-Grain healthy snacks, which are actually fruit packets.
Are they all the same? Strawberry. Do you like these, or is that Fred that likes these?
Oh, that's candy.
Is that Fred that likes
these? I love them. And they are candy. Yes. I don't know. Yeah. So what you're telling me is your plan.
Active citizen participation. Citizen participation.
Yes.
Present for the next committee further recommends.
Okay, do we have draft language? We want to review a potential modification here.
Would you like me to read number three?
Yes, so let's read number three. This is the proposed language.
Okay, in consideration of these potential charter amendments, the committee recommends that council actively engage the community to determine best practices that are most applicable to Columbus, especially in the topics of apportionment and reapportionment, timeline for placement on a ballot, process for implementation should voters approve the measure, and active citizen participation in the apportionment process. Further, the committee recommends that the community be given the opportunity to offer input at every phase of the process.
I like that.
How about you using that?
Yeah.
If the committee likes that, we will need a motion to amend.
Mr. Mills, did you hear that modification? I think you're still on mute.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I heard the modification. I'm supportive.
Okay, fantastic. So I'm going to make a motion to amend item number three as just read by Mr. Johnson. Is there a second to that amendment?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Okay. I now make a motion to support item number three as amended. Is there a second to that?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed?
Aye.
Okay, Mr. Mills is opposed.
No, I'm not opposed.
Oh, okay, sorry, we had a delay in the voting, sorry. Okay, Mr. Mills was supportive of that, so all those present were...
I vote yes.
Vote yes, got it. And again, I will leave the vote open if Pastor Laws is able to join us later.
Who seconded the motion to accept the recommendation?
I believe that was John.
John.
Here did the first
amendment,
John
then John.
The second.
Okay. So we've covered the council size and structure. So now we're moving on to vacancies and appointments, which is section five. And I'm going to divide this into two parts again. So we're going to cover items 1 through 5, and then we will cover the item at the top of the second page. So we're going to start with Lourdes again.
Hi, I'm ready.
Okay.
So, for number one, I just have a question, clarity. To require that council establish via the administrative code the process for filing a vacancy. Why did we put that on there? I wanted to understand the.
Placing that process in the administrative code gives council, one, the flexibility to flesh out the language itself.
Right, so it's changing, so whatever changes we have, that's putting that into the administrative code?
Yes, which also requires a two-thirds majority to approve or amend, so it wouldn't be a simple majority to do that.
Okay. Okay.
Any other comments to items 1 through 5?
Not right now, no.
Okay, Carrie?
I think I'm good.
Okay, John?
I have no comments on this section.
This is going much smoother than I anticipated, Jeanette.
And so.
Okay. I always speak too early.
No, I just feel, you know, we really need to address and say nonpartisan. This is a nonpartisan process. This is a charter change. We have nonpartisan elections, and I think we should make sure that this reflects that this would be a nonpartisan process. And where that word goes in, I'm not sure, but I would not like to have a charter language to be silent on it.
Okay, so you're looking for language that would overall just reaffirm that it's a nonpartisan process.
Yes. To continue with our nonpartisan elections, that when we're filling a vacancy, we are continuing with that same process of a nonpartisan process.
Okay. If staff could think about that. Mr. Mills, did you want to add something to that? You might.
No, thank you. I'm good with 1 through 5.
1 through 5. Okay. Could we just add something sort of to the introductory sentence that just reaffirms that we have nonpartisan elections? I was trying to quickly see where that was in here somewhere, but it's not in items 1 through 5.
And we're looking up the section of the charter. There is a section, I believe, of the charter that does specify that our elections are done on a nonpartisan basis. So I guess, do you want to make sure that this would be placed into charter language, or are you just, would you like to emphasize it as a committee?
Because this is new language, and it's about filling a vacancy that's different from what we already have. I don't want it to be silent. I don't want there ever to be any doubt that this should be a nonpartisan process. So 10 years from now, someone can say, nope, only members of a certain party will be considered.
So I think you're not necessarily asking for a change. You're just asking for it to be made clear in this particular area, in this particular
language.
Yeah,
it's new, but because we are very specifically nonpartisan, I don't want there ever to be,
right,
when we're long gone, any doubt that this section is also
meant to be nonpartisan.
So
I guess that's what you're looking for, is what language already surrounds this, where this would be interjected.
Yeah, maybe you
inserted.
Refer back to
the
language, you know. Refer back to the charter language that says, as that's such that these are nonpartisan elections, mm-hmm, something to refer back to it. I just don't want it to stand alone.
John.
Madam Chair, in the spirit of that, we can simply disclaim that no change is intended by this language to charter section yada yada, which refers to the nonpartisan nature of the elections.
Sounds legalese to me.
Quick fix.
Does that make sense for staff, that we just want to clarify that no recommendation here intends to, our intention is not to recommend any change to the nonpartisan election process?
Chair, co-members of the committee, that would be a reference to Section 41 of the Columbus City Charter, Section B, that provides that candidates for all offices to be voted on at any municipal election under the provisions of this charter shall be nominated at a nonpartisan primary. So that's the section of the charter that references the nonpartisan elections.
Well, see, I think this is different. This is something new that's addressing vacancies on council and disregarding the political numbers.
I mean, do we just want to add? I'm just talking
out
loud.
It should be an open process.
Do we want to add an item number 6? Mr. Johnson.
I apologize, Chair Co-member Brad. We might have a solution. Number
5. So up to the comma, vacancies must be filled by a person residing in the same district, comma, consistent with the city's nonpartisan electoral system.
No.
No?
Maybe I'm not being clear. You know, we're changing, filling, we are basically putting in the charter a way to fill a vacancy that we don't have now. And if we look at our past practices, I think it's been anyone who wants to apply. But because we are putting this language in the charter, I want it to be specifically stated that anyone can apply, because this is a nonpartisan process. That's what I'm trying to get at.
So I guess where I was going was, I'm just trying to talk out loud here, can we add an item number 6 that just says something to that sort of effect, that we recommend that the city continue to have a nonpartisan process, including in filling vacancies and appointments?
Because technically they don't have to do that. There isn't anything that says that they can't only limit applicants to one party.
And I guess even if we make a statement like that, they could still choose whoever they want to choose.
Yes, that's the point.
I mean, so the language isn't restricting council from picking who they ultimately decide to select.
It's a gentle reminder.
Who said earlier, if it's not in writing, it didn't happen, so.
If it's not in writing, someone will say, well, I don't think that's what they meant 20 years ago.
Chairco, members of the committee, what if we amended item number one to read, to require that council establish via the administrative code the process for filling a vacancy, comma, provided that such process shall remain nonpartisan.
I like it.
I like it.
Okay. Any comments or concerns about that addition? Okay, then I move to amend vacancies and appointments, item number one, to now read as Brian just said, which I believe is to require that council establish via the administrative code the process for filling a vacancy, provided such process shall remain nonpartisan. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Mr. Mills, all those opposed?
I'm a yes.
Yes, okay. Now, now I make a motion to approve vacancies and appointments, section 5, items 1 through 5, as amended. Is there a second to that?
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed?
Aye.
Mr. Mills, you were voting in support, correct?
Yes.
Thank you. Okay. We're moving on to the second part of vacancies and appointments, the top of the second page of most of our notes. It currently reads, the Charter Review Committee recommends that council adopt a policy related to the filling of vacancies. In addition to public hearing requirements for all vacancies, council shall have a preference for appointing a person who will not run for council at the next succeeding municipal election unless, based on the totality of the circumstances, council finds that this limitation would not be in the city's best interest. So once again, we're gonna start with Lourdes and see what people are thinking.
When we discussed, we being everyone else who was here and not me, this particular point, did we talk about what is the transparency there? So in the totality of appointing Carrie versus the totality of appointing you, uh-huh. How do we make that decision and how do people then know what that decision is? Or I'm wondering, just because I think that this goes back to that transparency. I mean, there may be subtle differences in why we choose some. In some instances, it may be very clear. Yeah. I'm just wondering if we had that discussion.
So I think there were two parts I would say to this. I think the discussion was in part that this idea of having a public hearing, that would sort of allow the community to see the candidate or candidates that council had narrowed it down to, and see how they answer questions. Again, letting council decide exactly what that question and answer process looks like, but that at least the community would be given the chance to see, you know, why they're putting this person up or these people, number one. Number two, the prior recommendations that the vote to approve or disapprove that person did not occur on the same day, to allow the community to have time to have feedback after seeing that kind of process. I think item number three goes to the discussion that I think many of us felt like or feel like the best option here is that those that they appoint to fill a seat don't run in the next election, kind of addressing the incumbency issue and some of that. Although I think being that specific may create challenges that we aren't prepared to deal with. So what if there were four vacancies at one time? You know, there are a number of factors that might change those circumstances. So I think ultimately it came down to this language from my perspective, because we want to encourage council to look at this idea of appointing someone who will not run, but yet recognizing that there will probably be circumstances where that doesn't make the most sense or is not in the best interest of the city. Sure. But kind of putting that back on council to then say, this is why we're not appointing someone who's not going to run, if that makes any sense. So I think we're giving them the flexibility that, depending upon the totality of the circumstances, they could make a decision and not have it be a charter rule that this person could not run. Because I think it then escalates into a lot of other topics. Council can always apply this rule without us amending a charter to say it can't be. Right. It has to be someone who won't run again. But this, to me, gives them the flexibility of deciding when they go back to item number one.
Yep.
They can decide in their own rules. Maybe they want to say that no one will run for a seat, but then they could change that without having to amend the charter. I hope that's making some sense.
No, that all makes sense, I guess. And I don't know if this is getting too nitpicky or not. I feel like what concerns me most about this is the communication of when there is a difference. Mm-hmm. That's what concerns me most, because I think that in some situations that could be very clear. In other situations where it's not, I think that's where issues arise.
Yeah.
Even if we do have a public hearing, whatever whatever these situations are, I still think, you know, and maybe that is left up to council. I'm putting the question out there, playing devil's advocate. If I look at that, I definitely see situations where this person is appointed and they're not running, but then this person is appointed and for whatever reason they are, right? And so while we, you know, what is the mechanism for then council to share that with people as to why are we, why is this person able to run and why is another person not?
My personal thought process would be, if you're the candidate that's sitting there being questioned in whatever format, that number one, I would expect that they would have decided before there were even applicants whether this is a position that you're going to be able to run for or not. It shouldn't be dependent upon who the applicant is.
Right.
So that should already be decided. So I would think that even before you have a person sitting there, you've had council explain why, you know, because of the fact
there's... So the process would be they would make that decision before saying we are having, this is a placeholder, or this is an open...
That's what I would expect, that when there's a vacancy, they would make a determination as to, you know, again, if there were four vacancies at one time, they may very well not want to have placeholders in all four vacancies. On the other hand, if there was one and it's 2 months before the election, maybe they will have a placeholder. So, but I would expect that decision to be made before you look at the pool of applicants. Is that a fair explanation?
Chair Coe, members of the committee, I think that's a great question. When we looked at Seattle and the process that they used, they always announce it in advance. So it's announced when they announce that there's a vacancy. So the expectation would be that the council here would do the same thing. And would just also note that I think Seattle was the primary peer city that we identified that had voluntarily done this. The one city that does it as a matter of charter is San Diego, and they only apply it in an election year. So just to kind of give a flavor for the data that sort of backed up, I think, where the committee got to this point.
I think it would make sense to somehow capture that within this, that I understand giving them the flexibility, but I do think making it clear that that decision would be made before is not clear within this, and I feel like it, I would feel more comfortable. I mean, I'd be interested to hear what other members of the committee would think, but I could be swayed. I just feel like this is a point that's left open, and in other areas we've been clear about making sure that the process is fair, and so I think having some sort of language in there, I would feel more comfortable.
I see writing already. I guess I would echo that. My belief would be that before you even ask for applicants, you've determined this is a seat that we're going to fill as placeholder or a caretaker versus the other. So as they potentially draft language, we'll keep talking. So, Carrie, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, I mean, I have a bunch of thoughts, but the specific question I have before I, you know, express those is, so this is also partly contingent on the person who is selected committing to not running again, right? Because one of the things that, you know, there could be a strong likelihood of is someone gets appointed, says I'm not going to run, all of a sudden has a change of heart, wants to run. So I think that's something that, you know, we need to think about. I'm not, I think I've expressed this throughout the course of these deliberations. I'm not a huge fan of the placeholder concept. I appreciate the language here sort of being a bit vague, to your point, gives the council a little bit of discretion in this respect. I think that I would, if we made any changes to this, I actually might differ a little bit in the sense that I would be, you know, probably even less specific than the current language, just to say, you know, we think this should be something, we think placeholders should be something that council should consider more frequently in the nomination or the appointment process. Those are just my views.
Okay, thank you. John?
I do have something substantive on this section, but I need a predicate. This district at large thing we've talked about, I think offers an interesting change in the dynamic, because I believe there will be a special relationship between the voters in a district and the candidate from that district. And we may get people looking past party and more into the personality and the performance and those intangibles. And I think I don't think it'll be a sea change, but I think it's a little change. And it's the responsibility of each district to reward the resident, if you will, who perform for them. And that's a little different. That's layered onto, did we do a great job for the whole city, but also, did you do a great job for my district? That's a change in the dynamic. And I tell you about that because this is a tiny little change in dynamic, but the two things put together may cause a more diversity of representation, if I may be kind, about who ultimately serves. For that reason, I'm disappointed in the word choice here, because we talk about a preference that you can take yourself out of based upon the totality of circumstances. Those words don't go far enough to make me happy. Not that making me happy is a goal here, but I think we're looking for a presumption that the person won't serve. And I understand that we can't predict all of the iteration of circumstances. And I think the language to take yourself out of the presumption is council's determination that extraordinary facts and circumstances warrants a departure from the presumption. This is shades of gray. This talks about preference and based it then subject to being trumped by a totality of circumstances. I'm more comfortable with a presumption and then a determination that we have extraordinary facts and circumstances to take yourself outside the rule. So that's where I'm at on it. I tinker with the words, but I think in a pretty significant way.
Jeanette?
I'm sorry. I still look at the flexibility, I guess. I understand the flexibility. I guess what I'm looking at is a preference of how strong a language is this in actuality for council? Because I'm thinking if we don't, council can do this right now. And I do have some issues with regard to, you know, I'll be honest, I don't know how we can really make this hold water. I mean, what if someone changes his or her mind?
May I
yes.
offer a thought on that? I think somebody who said they would assume a seat on council and not run got a real burden to carry when they change their mind. I think that's an uphill battle. So I think it counts. They certainly can depart and maybe still win, but they're going to have to carry a little load with them when they change their mind.
And I think as we discussed these sections, we really came back to a lot of these questions about party support and all those kinds of things. And I would expect that if council and the person agree that they're not going to run for election and that person turns around and runs, I would expect there would be some party challenges as well. So, you know, I think to everyone's point, we're not sort of guaranteeing this is impossible. You are still leaving it up to people doing what they say they're going to do, but hopefully the voters will take care of that issue if you don't do what you say you're going to do. I think, and I'll get to Mr. Mills in a second, I struggle with this issue on both sides because I see the reasoning and the value of why people feel like appointing a caretaker has positive benefits. But I struggle with whether that's the right thing to do every time, and putting out language that's as clear and you know, John, as you suggested, that's more clear. I struggle with that a little bit, and I probably struggle with it more now as we've talked about this idea of having the district component, because you're really left to find that person within that district, and you know, versus maybe retired members of council who want to serve for the 3 months or the 4 months, when, right, when now you're limited to geography, that you're going to have to find that person within these boundaries. And I think that alone, to me, could be one of these totality of the circumstances. I mean, what is the likelihood that that person or persons are available and interested? I mean, I think we've talked before that there's certain people in certain circumstances in their life that would be open to a short-term appointment like that. And there are others that, you know, that would be, you know, to leave a career and take that opportunity for only a few months probably wouldn't be reasonable. So I lean towards, as we've gone with the district component, that maybe this is making this as strong as we have discussed, maybe more of a challenge than it was when you had the entire city population to consider filling a vacancy.
Jeanette. I did have a question on the district at large. So we're saying that they would have to be filled by someone from that same district where they're vacating. And this way, we would still have, so they would have to appoint, they'd have to find someone in the district and say, we'd like you to serve, but you can't run. Correct. Or if council thinks that that's not the way to go, they could say that we want to find someone in the district and that not running restriction would go away.
Yes. I mean, as we've written it, council could do that.
That's what I'm saying. So yes. It's this flexibility.
Yes.
And, you know, there's the appearance. I understand the flexibility, but I'm wondering how is this going to be perceived by the public? I understand exactly what we're trying to do. We're trying to make that an open seat without any incumbency benefits, et cetera, et cetera. But I'm just looking at it from the public's perspective that one position will be you can't run, and then the other position can be you can run to fill that seat that you're sitting in that election. And that's where I have, because it does come across as unfair.
I think that's where I'm going. If we recommend this, then you're really putting a pretty high burden on council to come up with a reason why they wouldn't follow this. And then you immediately get into those inconsistent arguments. Why did this neighborhood not get someone who could run and that one did? And again, I like the concept, but when you go to flesh it out, I'm having a really hard time with how that best represents the people too. Because if you've got a great candidate, you know, in one neighborhood that the people want to run, I mean, that maybe that's supportive, but they can't. You know, or they have to leave that seat vacant for X period of time because they can't find a candidate who's interested. Because as you think now about the list of people who apply, they're coming from citywide. But the next time you'd have a vacancy, they would really only be coming from, not the next time, but after this process goes through, they'd only be coming from that district. And
whether we had the district, say we didn't have the district, it would still be, well, why did this particular seat,
yes,
why did you put the burden on this person not to be able to run, but then you allow this person to run for that seat in the next, there may be good intentions, but I don't know how the public will perceive that. And, you know, we've looked at this to try to be fair and open, but really the only fair and open is one, a special election where everybody starts from ground zero, or leave it vacant. And we've gone around and around on that because
I would add,
Go ahead, Kerry.
I mean, I would add, you know, I have stated before that I think the power of incumbency is greatly overstated in this context. If the person is not chosen again and the political process continues the way it has, you're essentially going to have the power of, you know, running with the county party endorsed slate. That is really where the influence comes from, is running as a team that is endorsed by the county party. Whether that person is an incumbent for 2 weeks or 2 years is far less, in my view, relevant than running as a team with a slate with an endorsement from the local party. Mm-hmm. So I think that that is why, primarily, I do not think that we should put restrictions or, you know, be specific to council on what they can and can't do in this regard. Again, I think this language tries to just suggest, but even in my view, it's a little bit too much. And I think these are some good examples of a whole host of questions and challenges that could arise. The other thing I'll say is, you know, the steps that we're doing preceding this, you know, are also an attempt to create openness and transparency with this appointment process. So if we weren't doing anything else, you know, in Section 5, and it was just this, I may feel differently, but, you know, we're putting a number of stipulations in this recommendation that really open up the process and really require that process to be open up, you know, in a way that hasn't been done before. So I feel very comfortable with the lengths that we've gone to in this commission to be sensitive to the calls for change. I think we are, up to this point thus far, have you know, met those considerations, you know, more than halfway in many respects. I don't feel comfortable supporting, you know, any further like stipulations on council that they should you know, consider a placeholder. I would be more comfortable modifying this language to just simplify it and say something along the lines of, you know, these aren't their right words, but just something along the lines that, you know, this commission, you know, urges council to consider, you know, where appropriate, a placeholder or a placeholder candidate, and end it at that. That would be that's what I would be comfortable with, or something to that effect.
I want to get to Mr. Mills, but I guess as I'm thinking through all of this, I mean, on item number one in the previous discussion, we're requiring them to establish a process that's in the administrative code. Council has most recently used a caretaker appointment, so it's clearly something they're aware of, clearly something they know is an option. And I guess I'm probably opposed at this point, I'm trying to think through this, to that entire section or recommendation, and just leaving it to items 1 through 5 that we've already said, go establish a process, and they can decide what's in that process. If council ultimately feels like it's okay to recommend that they always use a caretaker, then they can write that into their language. If they want to craft language they think gives them the flexibility as needed, they're the ones who have to make the appointment and serve the community as a whole. So I think I'm leaning towards not recommending this entire section and leaving 1 through 5 as we've already recommended. But Mr. Mills, we haven't given you a chance to speak, so I think you're still on mute. There you go.
I appreciate the opportunity. It's been a good discussion. If I'm a dispatch reporter, I probably lead with writing a story about what we're doing here. I would lead with this, you know, expand from 7 to 9 in a district at large format. But equally as important is this interim appointment process. And I would really hate to see us back away from this item. I would even go back to where John was with the presumption. But all that said, I'm for the language as printed and distributed. I would really hate to see us back away from it. I think this is an important point.
Thank you. I'm going to take a recess for maybe 10 minutes unless anyone has any comments they want to make before we take that recess. Okay, so we're going to recess until 2:40. We'll come back and talk to you, Mr. Mills. Okay, so where we left off was the second part of the vacancies and appointments section. And what I asked staff to do in part was to modify the language. I guess, again, I realize we're not all on the same page here, that's less specific. And my main concern is that when we first started talking about this language, we were talking about leaving the structure of council at large. And I felt pretty strongly that this was important then. I'm very concerned now that we have put more limits on where candidates are going to come from. In particular, that's my concern. So I lean towards not supporting this section at all and wanting to just defer to items 1 through 5 that we already supported. But I recognize that there is a significant interest in having seats filled by caretakers. So again, my eyes are horrible. Can someone read the language as potentially amended? Fred, can you hear this, hopefully?
The new section, if amended, would read... The new section, if amended, would read, the Charter Review Committee recognizes that council has recently utilized an appointment process whereby an appointee will not run for council at the next succeeding municipal election. The committee recommends that council adopt a policy related to the filling of vacancies in addition to public hearing requirements as follows. 1, based on the totality of circumstances and when appropriate, council will continue to fill a vacancy by appointing a person who will not run for council at the next succeeding municipal election. This decision should be announced prior to accepting applications to fill a vacancy.
Okay, so I'm not sure how this next few processes are gonna go, so we're just gonna try this out. So I'm gonna make a motion. Yes, please.
If I may, please, because I've been one of the champions of this notion of the interim appointee. Two things. First of all, I can count noses. This is all about getting what you can get. That's number one. And number two, I want to acknowledge that your point about the district at large being a very important consideration as we wrestle with these words. And I still like presumptions and extraordinary circumstances, but I take your point. I think it goes in the mix. So this language gives it a big shove in the right direction. And so I can live with this.
Fantastic. Okay, so I'm going to make a motion to amend the language as drafted to be what Edward just read into the record and as we're seeing on the screen. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Thank you, John. All those in favor?
Aye.
All those opposed?
Aye.
Aye. So, Mr. Mills, that was a vote in opposition, correct?
It was.
Okay.
Nay.
Nay.
Oh, no, I didn't hear that. Did he say that?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't
get
that.
He said, I don't know.
No, he didn't use the word nay, but... He said aye to my anyone opposed.
No.
So he is a yes.
Thank you.
Exactly. Okay, so the section has been amended, and I'm just gonna have Edward read that again so we're not confused. So I'm gonna make a motion to support this language.
The Charter Review Committee recognizes that council has recently utilized an appointment process whereby an appointee will not run for council at the next succeeding municipal election. The committee recommends that council adopt a policy related to the filling of vacancies in addition to public hearing requirements as follows. 1, based on the totality of circumstances and when appropriate, council will continue to fill a vacancy by appointing a person who will not run for council at the next succeeding municipal election. The decision should be announced prior to accepting applications to fill a vacancy.
Thank you. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed?
Aye.
And again, just to confirm, Mr. Mills, you are in opposition to that motion, correct?
No. I voted for that motion. I would rather have had the stronger language, but I am supportive of the compromise now.
Okay, fantastic. So everyone who voted, voted in favor of the amended language.
So you were voting for less.
Yes,
language.
For what Edward read into the record.
Did he change it from the last time?
No, same thing.
Oh, okay, that's what I was looking like.
No. Just to clarify, we amended the language.
I was looking at this, and when we did it again, I thought he had changed something. No. I couldn't figure out what he had changed.
It was the same.
So
it was a test.
I'm not trying to make it more complicated, but I seem to be. Okay, so we have, I think unanimously for all those here, approved the amended language as presented. And again, I'll leave that open if Pastor Laws or Frieda choose to vote later. Okay, so we're moving on to employment status. We have two sections remaining. Employment status just has one point. So our recommendation, I guess, would say that the Charter Review Committee recommends no charter change to the employment status of members of council. The Charter Review Committee further recommends that council study a first obligation policy and determine if such policy suits council's needs. So we would be making no recommendation for specific charter changes, but encouraging council to consider how they internally define the, and this stemmed from the full-time, part-time debate and the fact that our charter is silent on that topic. So, Bordis, we're starting at that end of the table.
I'm good.
Carrie?
I'm good. Okay.
John?
John Rosenberger. I'm fine with the first sentence. I'm uncomfortable with the second sentence. I don't even want to get on that slippery slope.
You would delete the second sentence?
I would. First obligation starts to professionalize, and that bothers me. I was just with somebody who had served on council just recently, and she launched into the importance of, you know, making a living in the community, making payrolls, having clients, having customers, and this whole notion that this even takes even a mini step towards full-time, an expectation of full-time service being a step in the wrong direction. So I can't get comfortable with the second sentence. I'm sorry.
Okay. Jeanette?
I'm agreeing with John. I think it's the length. I'm sorry. I think there needs to be a study. When we were discussing this, I thought there were some holes that, you know, it really wasn't our responsibility to fill, specifically with regard to the fact we now have a compensation review commission or whatever. I would like for council to study it, but not put in that they're studying a first obligation policy. I think that council should look at the position and make determination. It may not necessarily push it into that first obligation, because I guess this is telling them that we think that there should be a first obligation. And that's not what I thought was the result of our conversation when we said no charter change about doing that. So I'm agreeing with that this might give the wrong, it would give the wrong impression of my view. I think they should study it, make all those arguments, come up with whatever arguments that they feel will be appropriate to make their position known to that wage, the salary compensation committee.
John, would you be comfortable with language that says they should study it if the words like first obligation were taken out of that?
I really like the first sentence. I just don't see, they can study anything they want to.
Yeah.
And we can take every sentence here and add they should study it. It doesn't advance the dialogue. So.
Okay.
Just as a question.
I agree. Just take it out.
Just as a question before we get to Mr. Mills. Council could today make rules, policies about how council functions that would require members to spend X number of hours doing certain things. I mean, so what I'm getting at is council already has the ability to sort of dictate how members spend time. Is that fair?
No, they don't.
Or they don't. That's
no,
what I
they
need
don't.
To clarify.
I don't think they can, because council, unless it's changed, it is all your determination. Once you are elected, it is all your determination. And you know, I'm agreeing. John, we're agreeing. Maybe that's because I'm sitting next to you. But I think, you know, and that was why I'm reluctant about this first obligation policy, because that's giving, you know, our authority recommendation that they should go down that path. So I agree. Let's just say no charter change, and they can do whatever they want.
Mr. Mills, what do you think?
I agree with John. I would just as soon see that second sentence deleted.
Okay. Any reconsideration over here? Are you comfortable with the second sentence being deleted, or you feel like it strongly needs to be there?
I mean, I don't feel like it strongly needs to be there. I mean, I do think that the conversation, what we talked about with council before, is an important conversation, whether that's in our purview to make a recommendation. I am ambivalent about, given the other things that we need to consider, so.
Well, I wrote down, I think, every meeting, John, familiarity and accountability. And no matter what you say, it's still how a specific member chooses to interact and be accountable to the community, regardless, that was sort of where I was going with the hours, regardless of how many hours you say I have to do something, or regardless of whether you call me full-time or part-time, you know, ultimately it's up to the person you elect to choose how they're going to use that time. I mean, you could tell them to sit here for 8 hours a day, but that doesn't mean they're going to do anything that the community feels is worthwhile. So, Carrie, anything else you want to add?
I'm fine with if we change it and eliminate that second sentence.
Okay. I am too. I mean, I think council should continue because of, I think where we're struggling a little bit is there's this committee on compensation, and they have to look at things that are sort of in the record. But I think council can address that. I don't feel comfortable with us telling them how to look at what does first obligation mean, and I struggle with what does that mean. I mean, does that mean X number of hours? Does it mean what I think of first? Does it mean what meeting I don't miss? I don't know what that means. So I guess I would move to amend the section as proposed to delete the second sentence and leave the first sentence. Is there a second to that?
Second.
We're going to say Jeanette seconded that. All the they're getting way too comfortable down here. All those in favor?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Thank you. Anyone opposed? Okay. Now that we have an amended section, he supported the deletion. So now I make a motion to support the recommendation that would just simply read, the Charter Review Committee recommends no charter change to the employment status of members of council. Is there a second to that?
Second.
Jeanette seconded that. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you. Anyone opposed? Okay. All right, supporting area commissions. I believe this is the final area that we had talked about. Obviously, if anyone feels differently, we'll cover that in a second. So supporting area commissions, we're gonna consider all together, and I'm just gonna walk through this. The language says, while area commissions are not a charter matter, they advise multiple branches of city government and play a role in further promoting citizen engagement in local government. Stronger area commissions will continue to foster a city council responsive to the needs of our growing city. The Charter Review Committee recommends further study by the City Council and the Mayor to strengthen the operation and efficiency of area commissions. The committee specifically recommends a process similar to the current Charter Review Committee. To that end, the committee recommends a commission on area commissions to study the following. One, providing area commission coverage for every city resident. Number two, addressing administrative support needs for area commissions, including, but not limited to, funding, staff support, web hosting, records retention, organizational development, training, and community engagement. Three, streamlining and equalizing the organization and operation of area commissions, including, but not limited to, uniform bylaws, elections, zoning processes, and public notice and participation. And finally, number four, ensuring adherence to city and state laws regarding open meetings and open records. So we will start again with Lourdes and your thoughts on this section.
And I think I voiced this before, was just thinking about what are these other neighborhood groups, whatever, how, you know, given that they carry weight and they've been established, but I think number one covers that. So understanding what that relationship is and having that be part of the study, as long as everyone is under an area commission, I think covers that concern.
Okay. Thanks. Carrie?
I think this looks good. It's broad, but that's fine. Mm-hmm. I think the one thing I would like to consider is putting some language in here about the urgency of this or doing it more quickly. If we're looking out over a longer time horizon for the other changes that we've discussed, and this too is just a study, I'd like to see that study get started pretty quickly.
I think that makes a lot of sense. John?
I'm pleased with the language as is.
I'm okay.
Mr. Mills?
Just one suggestion, and that is, I think the proper term at the very last paragraph or section or item four is open meeting and public records.
Yes.
As opposed to open records.
That makes sense to me. So the two comments.
But other than that, I'm in favor of it.
Thank you. The two comments that I was thinking about have both been mentioned. So urgency, I think we probably want a comment sort of at the beginning of this, or maybe it's in the cover letter. I mean, I'm not necessarily saying the recommendations change, but I do think the process to move to a district structure will take a lot longer, kind of what we had talked about before when we were just talking about keeping it at large. That I think there are things that can be done to address area commission issues a lot sooner and to better use the resources that we talked about, whether it's, I'm gonna get the names wrong, but whether it's like the community engagement group from this from city council, the mayor's staff. I mean, there's things that are out there that maybe just not all area commissions are aware of and utilizing. So I think there's things that could be done quickly, which I think would go with that. And the other thing is, I think that the idea of covering every resident under an area commission kind of addresses the civic associations. And I'm just talking out loud a little bit, but is there or could we put something in about the civic associations? And I'm just sort of talking out loud, but is there some way to better define civic associations? Or I guess what I'm getting at is there's that list now of 298 civic associations. I mean, could the Department of Neighborhoods do a better job in the future? I don't mean they're not doing a good job, but do a better or different job in the future now that there is a Department of Neighborhoods of defining what civic associations are active and kind of keeping that a little bit more engaged. I think there are email lists. I mean, I'm personally on them. I mean, I think they're getting materials out there, but I have no idea if they're getting to all 298. Are those 298 still active? I mean, are we looking at a list that really is 50 civics and not 298? So I'm just wondering if there's something we should put in here to flesh out this idea of involvement from civic associations. Jeanette and then John.
I spoke about this before about including civic associations, and I don't know if we can put it right here under supporting commissions, but in previous language, you were talking about offering training and things of that nature. And I guess I would like something just to say to engage and to engage and offer support to the civic associations, because the civic associations are still going to be in existence with the commissions.
Yeah. And I guess my thought process is it's done now, but I think it's done sporadically. So if we had a more sort of formal process that some civics have found a way to get information and others probably don't.
And that's why I like the part when you were talking earlier, I think it was in there where you were saying training and letting them know about services. And I'm just saying it to engage and support the civic associations as well, because they are a vital component of this city.
Yeah, I agree. John?
I felt the itch you were trying to scratch had to do with just the pure form of area commissions and the fact we don't all have that.
Yeah.
And maybe just the wiggle room of area commissions or equivalent, just something to sort of signal that we understand there are organizations out there that fill an equivalent capacity.
Yeah.
Just trying to throw in a couple words that maybe are responsive to your concern.
Yeah.
See, I think we need to say it's civic association.
I almost think you're talking about two different things, because I think part of the challenge.
Well, but I'm talking about language, because the commission serve one established formal role, and I don't want it to be the civic association to be less than.
Yeah.
I mean, there are different roles. Those civic associations are very important in that specific community.
Yes.
They know they feed into the commission. So I would just not, I was still, you know, that's what I'm talking about, the language to make them feel included. And it may not be part of here, maybe, you know, another section, probably support to the civic associations or something of that nature.
John, where I think you're going is, part of one of my questions is there are at least two strong civic associations where there are not area commissions, and telling them that they can no longer be, or that they have to now be an area commission is going to be a challenge. But so I think your point is sort of, or equivalent in the sense that we want a recognized body or recognition. And I think that goes to all civics though, because there's a lot of other civics.
There are others that aren't quite as large,
that
but
still
they
need recognition.
Are very active and organized.
I agree, exactly.
That, those are the ones that.
Yes. So know, they already fall under an area commission, but I think our point is sort of recognition of the civics. So have you guys taken anything we've been chatting about and made a point?
We're taking notes. We're trying to figure out how to civic, how to.
Maybe a separate section. It may not be under commissions. It may just be a separate.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
While they're doing their homework.
Yes.
You tagged a base that I think warrants a little energy, and it's not right on point, but then again, it's timely. You talked about urgency in conjunction with this. I wrote down here at the bottom of all this, urging council to implement some of the spirit of these things while the dialogue and the charter process weighs its way out. And as you know, I'm particularly attracted to this at-large district concept, and that's something that council can accomplish the spirit of without amending the charter. And I think our report, our recommendations, would have no mission if we didn't go out of our way to talk about accomplishing the spirit of this through councilmanic action where possible.
So what if, while you're all scrambling, what if our cover letter kind of addresses that? I think that's a really good point to all of this, the spirit of the recommendations, sort of overlying all of this, that there are things council can do right now. And using, I think the geography one is kind of the most obvious to me, that without formally having districts, council can still make geographic assignments, you know, whatever they want to call it, to give citizens more of a connection that I know I live on the west side and here's who the person I call is. So I think I like that in a cover letter versus a recommendation per se, because I think it overlies, that might not be the right word, I think it overshadows everything that we're kind of recommending, is that you can address the spirit without waiting for the formal parts.
May I respectfully stir it up a little bit? Been a couple references to cover letters. I don't know if cover letters have the dignity that the report itself will have, or whether that in fact simply becomes a transmittal letter that is tossed.
I guess I don't necessarily mean that. I meant more of, I think you used the word preamble before, but
thank you,
the explanation before the recommendations.
Thank
is what
you.
I was
We're
thinking,
in the same place.
Okay, I won't call it a cover letter.
Yeah. It's part of the document.
There, no, I agree. Not a cover letter, as in please review the attached.
Thank you.
Well, and I think that, you know, the preamble, or, you know, however we frame these recommendations, I would definitely like to flesh out a little bit, just in the sense that, you know, I think we've taken some great strides here to try to capture the spirit of the public testimony that we've heard, and I just want to make sure that we are kind of framing these recommendations in that context at some point, whether it's at the conclusion of this meeting or the next meeting or whenever. But, you know, I just want to make sure that, you know, given the fact that there hasn't been a lot of media coverage on this, and, you know that only a small sliver of the total population has really been tuned into this, I just want to make sure that we are, you know, thinking about how we communicate these recommendations based on all of our collective kind of thoughts and input over the course of the last 2 months.
That makes a lot of sense. Okay. Did anyone come up with a draft civic association language?
We can keep talking if you want.
Yeah. So I'm gonna let them think for a minute. Oh, nope, they're ready.
Well, Chairco, members of the committee, I think part of the sort of the challenge that we're having in trying to capture what the committee is saying and put it into recommendations and the words for recommendation are first, that the majority of that work that you're describing is done by the administration, not by council. In fact, most of what's in this section is done by the administration, not by council. The second is that area commissions are unique in that they're creatures of city code. So while civics have been recognized in some sense, they are self-selecting, whereas area commissions are not. So I think part of the challenge in how far the city would go in providing some of these services to a civic is the very nature of civic associations. They're not something that the city engages in terms of bylaws, public meetings, that sort of thing. So it does create a little bit of a challenge. And one thing that I would also add, of the 296 roughly that we have on that list, that has some overlap. So that would be areas that have an area commission, but then also have civics under it. It includes block watches. It includes sort of the whole gamut of ways that the community organizes itself and engages with the city. So I think that's kind of where our challenge is coming in. You know, where does that fit in that the city engages with these groups in the same way that it would engage with a trade association or, a neighborhood group that pops up around a particular issue? How do we differentiate from that versus the other, for lack of a better term, special interest groups that we would engage with on a daily basis?
So in my head, I wasn't necessarily suggesting that we make these recommendations relative to civic associations for all those reasons you just said. I was more thinking along the lines of, having had involvement with area commissions, that list is awfully hard to go figure out which of these are in my area, how do we engage with them, oh wait, that person hasn't been involved in years. There was at least one on there that was in my area that nobody can tell me who the person was who's listed. I was more just thinking that, can we maybe just say like that we encourage council and the mayor to support the Department of Neighborhood's efforts to connect with civic associations and ensure civic associations are getting connected with area commissions. Something that just might encourage the Department of, I think it's the Department of Neighborhoods, to better get a grasp on, and maybe just that list gets updated to look at block watches to civic associations. Maybe even just the organization of the list, how often it's updated would help. I agree that we can't ask the city to provide these resources, and I don't want to. I don't think civic associations want that either. But I don't want to leave them out, because at the end of the day, I think as we talk about trying to have more transparency and more community involvement, we're fooling ourselves if we don't think civic associations are part of that. Whether it's the big ones or the little ones that are just strong in a 10-block neighborhood, they're strong in that neighborhood. So I think I just want to say something that recognizes a desire to support civic associations.
Yes, I agree. I didn't want, that's why I was saying make it separate. Yeah. I was not saying just add and civic associations on all of this. And I was thinking more with regard to council, because we had discussed before the new council engagement staff. And I was just trying to make sure that we recommend a connection between that engagement staff and the civic associations, and not just focus solely on the commissions, because they have a very distinct separate purpose. But the front line, as I said before, the front line of issues in the communities are in these very specific areas of the civic associations. So some language that I think, Edward, you had it before in one of the prior drafts about the community engagement office to continue to engage. There was something about 3 or 4 drafts earlier.
Do we track changes on that?
That it was specifically for outreach or something. I remember, because we talked about the civic associations before, and that's what I was thinking on lines of making sure that there is some sort of a connection, a communication with those group and recognition of those group, and not necessarily put all of the commission responsibilities.
Can we say it as simply as that we encourage council to continue to utilize the community engagement office to connect with area commissions and civic associations? I don't think we need to be detailed here. I just kind of want.
I think what I was referencing, what I was talking about, number one, was thinking, if you're going to have a commission on commissions this is definitely a big part of their conversation.
Yeah.
Right? And making sure, like, how are we connecting with them? How are we reaching out to them? How are we including everyone? Because, you know, I mean, this is a conversation that could go on all day, right?
Yeah.
You know, if you look at even, I like thinking of real, you know, neighborhoods and real situations, there's a really strong civic association right over from where we are, but there's no area commission, mm-hmm. right? So there, and the part of the neighborhood that needs an area commission or some representation has none, right? And so I think, and they have no relationship with the really strong civic association, mm-hmm. nor does I think that civic association want to have that relationship, right? So that's not necessarily, you know, I think that that's part of this, part of this work, and part of thinking how having this, that commission think, how do they all talk and how do they make those recommendations? I mean, I would not be opposed if we added that language in. I just think in my process, in my thought, in my thinking is all of those issues are part of that work, you know, and that they would really dig in deeper, much like we have on lots of other things. Yeah. So, I mean, I think if we feel strongly that we should acknowledge them in some way, I think that that's fine. But I do think that if we are recommending a commission on area commissions, that that's part of their Absolutely. Real purview is yeah. to figure out how do we provide resources and how do we make sure that everyone's included and that we're connecting people to the right resources.
Yeah. Yes, John.
I think the language about civic associations and honoring their service is also appropriate. I'm fine with that. I think we may have an unintended consequence by saying providing area commissions coverage for every citizen, city resident, may almost be read as suggesting that civic associations sort of don't count as much.
That's right.
And yeah. so I think we say here with it yeah. That there be a goal of expanding the footprints and the effectiveness of area commissions. It doesn't sound as like we're, I may also make this observation. If there are advantages to becoming an area commission, like funding and back office support and all that sort of stuff, maybe some are going to want to grow up and be an area commission, and that's a good result. But I think your point's so well taken. Let's just get out of the way. Change our words here a little bit and get out of the way and let the commission on area commissions do their thing.
I almost go back to leaving it just as written. I think I started this debate, sorry. I personally like fleshing out language about civic associations, but I think it might be unnecessary to your point, because I don't think you can address having area commissions cover every resident, what the elections look like, without ultimately addressing civic associations, so it's going to have to come up in that process. So I'd be okay with it as is, and I'll stop this debate. So is everyone else okay with it as is?
I mean, did you find the language that I was talking about?
Possibly. It's a large section. Do you want me to just pass it over? Or there is a section that we talk about council organization and outreach, and to continue doing that through the methods it's currently doing. Because one of the things we were discussing is, you know, our community outreach team, they give us reports. And as I'm recalling, I'm like, I get more reports from block watches and civic associations and these sorts of groups than I do from an area commission, which meets once a month. So in some ways, that outreach is currently happening, and the Department of Neighborhoods is, it's nascent, it's new, but it is doing a lot of this work that I think that the committee's discussing at this
so
point in time.
So the language that is the language I was thinking of. It just said continue. I think, didn't it say continue using the outreach? Because we had talked about all the existing prep.
Take from there, yeah.
Assessing the effectiveness and potential expansion of council's external affairs functions.
She wants to get rid of that, it sounds like.
I was, maybe it was just when we discussed it, but it was just saying what yeah. you were talking about,
yeah.
tying in and strengthening those existing connections with the civic associations. I mean, we can leave the commissions, but I just think that focusing only on the commissions and not at least acknowledging the role of civic associations in this important document, you know, whether it's just a separate commentary or to support,
yeah.
to continue to support or strengthen it.
I mean, is that, Mr. Mills, did you have something you wanted to add?
No, thank you.
Okay, just checking.
I'm good with the language as it is. I understand some concerns like Jeanette's about Pacific associations, but I'm good either way you want to go.
Okay. So what if we... What if we put it in the summary?
Yeah.
I think maybe when we come up with a preamble that we make sure the reference to civic associations is in there and not worry about putting it in as a recommendation specifically. So is that okay?
Oh, whatever the committee would like to do is okay.
Okay.
But to the extent that this is helpful, Edward and I were just talking through a way that might get at this. What if in the first paragraph of this recommendation, there was a sentence added that states, in making these recommendations, the committee recognizes the special role that civic associations play in the city of Columbus.
I'm okay with that.
Yep.
Okay, so I make a motion to add the sentence Brian just read at the end of the first paragraph in the section labeled supporting area commissions. Brian, will you read that sentence one more time?
It's up here.
Okay.
Hopefully. in making these recommendations, the committee recognizes the special role that civic associations play in the city of Columbus.
Okay, that's the motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
Jeanette, okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you. All those opposed? Okay, thank you. Now I make a motion to support.
Sure.
Yes, Carrie, sorry.
If the commission will indulge me, I would like to add an additional amendment into this.
Okay.
Just before it says the committee recommends a commission on area commissions to study the following, I would like to add recommends forming, this would be the inclusion, forming as soon as possible in 2018 a commission on area commissions to study the following.
Let me just clarify what you said.
Mm-hmm.
Forming it in 2018
as soon
as by
possible this year.
2017, you mean?
Or 2017, I'm sorry, yes.
Okay. I was like, we're waiting a whole other year?
As soon as possible year.
Right, yes, yeah, sorry. As soon as possible next year.
So he threw me off there for a second. I was like, okay.
Yeah.
Does staff see any harm in making that timely connected? I mean, we are only in February. It seems reasonable to me. Yeah, I mean, they can. Okay, so we're making Carrie's making a second, another motion to amend so that it would say, to that end, the committee recommends
forming as soon as possible in 2017
a commission on area commissions to study the following. Mm-hmm. So Carrie made that motion. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in. Sorry, Fred, go ahead.
I was just trying to be helpful in seconding something.
Okay. We're giving Fred credit for seconding that. Okay. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Okay. Fred, did you vote in support of that?
He seconded.
He seconded.
I did.
Okay, good. Just making sure the record reflects that. Okay, so now I make a motion to support this section with the two amendments that we've just passed. The language is on the screen if anyone needs to see that again, hopefully. Is there a second?
Second.
Carrie seconded that. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. All those opposed? Okay. So that concludes all the recommendations, I think. John, did you have
that? The question that we explored while they were authoring the revision about the notion of councilmanic action to advance the spirit of this. And maybe did you fix that out just on the basis of your old transmittal letter?
Yes.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So
not
it's
referred to as a cover letter anymore.
Thank you. But it's been dealt with, hasn't it?
I believe so,
Thank you.
So here's what I think will happen next. I don't think we need another meeting because the specific recommendations have all been voted on. So staff will put together these revisions we will put together a preamble, an introduction, not a cover letter, that will outline some of the key points, capturing the spirit of the public testimony, the fact council can act immediately on some of these things within the spirit, geography, and I think also I would like to see us talk a little bit about familiarity and accountability and some of the kind of topics that we felt strongly about. Then that'll be circulated via email. If there are any concerns, you can send them back to staff. If we need to have a meeting for some reason, we will, but I think our recommendations are final. So this is just a matter of making sure the introduction covers everyone's comments. So I believe we had another meeting tentatively scheduled, but the intention will be not to have that meeting. Staff have any idea on when we should expect this email and when you want sort of final comments back?
That is a fantastic question, Chair.
and we gave you another committee to take place.
Right, in case.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
You're welcome.
Not it.
Did you just say not it?
Yeah. We'll probably get this out by what, 15?
Yeah. Comments back. It's all no, actually. We should probably.
Yes.
To circulate comments so we know what comment and how is this going to work?
Might need some staff direction on that, but my thought would be that members submit their comments back to staff. If it's things that, you know, grammatical or things that can easily be changed, that staff will make those changes and resubmit them to the group. So I don't think we want people submitting comments to each other. Is that
correct?
Fair? So send your comments to staff, they can revise them.
As a timeline, so the next meeting is scheduled for the 17th, tentatively. We could for sure have clean copies of everything we've discussed out by the 14th, if not sooner. And we would humbly request that comments get back to us by the close of business on the 16th, or maybe even noon on the 16th, so that we can determine based on, you know, these are really substantive comments, you're gonna need to come in to that meeting on Friday. I don't know if that's not enough time or.
May I upset all this thinking for just a millisecond?
Yes.
When do we have news here? If we approve this, it's done. And nobody has the benefit of all this flowery presentation and explanation that we're proposing. I really think we should, I think this should be treated as an interim judgment. I think we ought to see a draft. I think we should mess around with the draft, and then I think we should approve it. Then we have what should be reported as our final recommendation. And by the way, since we have authority for telephonic meetings now, we can accomplish it by telephone call.
I would agree with that. I think it's just really important that we communicate these changes effectively to the public. I think these are significant changes. I would hate to miss the opportunity to help kind of put a punctuation mark on the end of what I think has been a very healthy and thoughtful discussion around some pretty significant changes. And I don't think necessarily that meeting would necessarily need to be a long meeting, but I think I like John's point about coming together, sort of putting a final stamp of approval on it and sending it off to the commission, or to the council, rather.
I agree.
Chair. Once this is done, after this, what is the formal process of presentation?
That's my next question.
because I think, you know, we've done this, we've looked at, I would feel more comfortable with the actual document to read it, especially when we're talking about preamble comments. You know, reading it through, we may want to add something, and I don't want to put the burden on staff to determine whether it's substantial or not of changes or. I think we need to review it ourselves and be comfortable with the language.
Okay, so I'm going to try to flesh all that into one thing. So staff will send us revised recommendations clearly by the 14th. Do you expect to have sort of a draft of the preamble by the 14th too?
We could, yes.
Okay, and then we're asking for comments back by the 16th at noon. But it sounds like we're all more comfortable meeting on the 17th. So let's still try to get comments back to staff so we have some idea about whether we have substantial substantive changes or if we're pretty close, so that they have some time to prepare for that on the 17th. Let's plan to meet on the 17th, hopefully reviewing a final version of what the report looks like. Is everyone comfortable with that? Okay, I'm gonna talk about the 17th in a minute, but what's the process after that? Like, so we say we're done on the 17th, we're happy with the report. What is the expectation for how that gets, what'd you say?
I'm just saying, John, we're out of here.
Yeah, we're out of here. So then what happens?
Sorry, so it's getting late in the day. So we're trying to think through all of this and make sure that we're capturing it correctly. So to restate what we'll be providing, the committee has approved the actual text of the recommendations today. Mm-hmm. We'll be providing the context and preamble, and then the committee will vote on sort of the full package on the 17th. Is that correct?
I think if we declare this language as the language, the stories happen. I think we bought into the draft on an interim tentative basis, but we want to see the context. I mean, I think we have to pull back just a half step here.
Yeah, I mean, to me, it's, you know, what we did today was we approved these measures individually, but I think to John's point, we come back and approve the report that we're sending off to the commission as a whole, which would include preamble language and other.
I think we're kind of saying the same thing. It's just a different format. So,
We're just trying to think through, you know, what the motions were and what's been approved. But yes, Edward had a point that it may make sense to give a deadline for public comment as well, because that will need to be provided and will need to be posted online. It may make sense to have that fall in line with the committee's comments back to staff. So that could be a possible.
That's not a fair window for the public to weigh in. I'm sorry.
I think our goal would be to post this immediately as provided, but I'm seeing not.
Yeah.
I'm troubled by that.
So help me out here. I think what you all are saying you're troubled by is you want the context around the recommendations before they're posted to get comment.
Pardon me for interrupting. And I think what it worked out today is still subject to change. Still subject to change. And short of that, the train has left the station.
So I don't know what our end timeline is. We kind of already went past that in January. So if I'm hearing kind of what I think is that the committee would like to sort of see the final report before it's published to the community and for their feedback on the final report, which makes it hard because if it's already final, so a semi-final report. So I think we would like to see the context that we surround this with, whatever you're calling that, the preamble or whatever, and then give the public, I would think, like 5 to 7 days to provide comments. Does that seem reasonable to most people?
Okay, so we're asking for public comments, because now we're getting public comments and we get the opportunity to read those at the next meeting.
A little bit.
So if we're getting public comments.
I think when they said that, I was leaning more towards cutting off the public comments that this committee has been soliciting since the beginning. Because I struggle with, when does that stop? I mean, because if we submit a semi-final report, there's public comments, are we going back and change? I mean, I think from my perspective, we'd be better off saying comments on these topics can be submitted until the 14th or whatever. And then, you know, we're going to review the preamble. I got to call it something. We're going to review the connecting language.
And we would have those comments?
And we would have whatever comments are submitted by, like, the 14th. I don't necessarily see public comments on the report.
Madam Chair,
missing something? No.
I'm still going back. What is proper protocol here? Because this is a convened commission review. What are we called?
Committee.
Well, what is the protocol before we talk about publishing everything? I mean, what is the protocol of presenting it to our appointing bodies? To me, that would be the way to do it. Brian, I look to you and to Edward, but I'm thinking we're missing. Uh-huh. Who gets the report?
So for council, per the charter, that would be provided to the city clerk. She is to receive official documents and letters and reports for council for the mayor's office that could be delivered either via myself or any other staff member in the mayor's office for his receipt.
I guess we're saying a bunch of things, and maybe this is just my not understanding, but would a report, a final report or a version of a final report, typically be presented to the public for comment before it's presented to the parties who formed the committee?
I think that's a step in the wrong direction, yeah. Even though I started it on that path yeah. with
No, I think okay. it's cut off, no, and so, it's so cut off, and then a report,
so
yeah.
So if what we're really saying is that we have been open to public comment this whole way, that public comment has to be submitted by X date. We need to pick a date, whether it's today, tomorrow, next week, whatever. Pick a date. Those are the final day to submit any public comments on this topic. To me, that date is before we have to submit all of our final comments back to staff on the draft final report.
I mean, the other thing is that this is available online.
Yeah.
This is, I mean, people
all
can
of this
view, right, and they can view this. So theoretically, they would have seen this.
Yeah, this is all
right?
out there.
Like, yeah.
Exactly.
So,
yeah. So
sorry, keep going.
I think this is where we're just talking in circles a little bit. So are my dates okay? Can we say final public comment on these topics is by February 14th? And then at that point, staff will send us any final public comments that were submitted. Staff will send us a draft of the preamble, a draft of the connecting language with these recommendations. They're asking that we return comments by noon on the 16th, the best we can. And then we will meet in person on the 17th. And flesh out where those comments came from, whatever else we need to add, and hopefully at the end of that have a final product that can then be submitted to the city clerk and to the mayor's office. Does that make sense?
So long as this is all subject to amendment until it's done.
Of course. I mean, until we say that's the final report.
I'm losing that just a little bit, and that makes me uncomfortable. But. Well, I think we're on the same place.
I would say that I agree with that. On the other hand, I don't intend to go rehash all the things that I think we've already hashed through. So, yes, but of course, if we don't like the connecting language or we don't like the underlying tone of it, I think we can continue to want to flesh out how items one connected to and all that kind of stuff. So I think we're saying the same thing, but I also think we're approaching having a final report, and ultimately we have to have a final report. And I believe, if I recall from the beginning, like all of the public comments will ultimately be included with the final report. So it's not just our recommendations and our every bit of all of this public submission. So our report will be huge. What we're recommending may only be. Because I think even the presentations then were all being included with the material. So pretty much everything we've looked at is being included.
Not to belabor this.
That. Yeah.
And not to belabor things,
uh-huh.
But are you, on our behalf, going to submit this to council at some point after the 17th?
That was part of my just understanding the process, but I assumed so, and I assumed there would be some, whether I addressed council at a meeting or a separate meeting, I assumed that would happen. Yeah.
It is.
I assumed that was going to happen.
Once council receives a report, my understanding is it is their intention to hold, at a minimum, a rules and reference committee hearing to go through this, if not a different sort of public context to do so, to kind of go through and understand and give the public the opportunity, I guess, to also make comment on the very final report in that context as well.
Makes sense.
And I guess my other thought just to the committee members would be that, you know, we're not all going to agree on everything, but I would love it if you had specific sort of points that you wanted made as we present this, you know, so that I don't lose sight of all those things. I think I have a pretty good idea of where most people were coming from, but I would love to, you know, if I had Carrie's three key points or, you know, those kinds of things as we go through this process, so.
Are you suggesting that the members could offer a supplemental commentary? I suppose what we have our one issue we wish would have been talked about. I mean, I think we can join in the report and maybe still comment.
I wasn't really thinking about it that way, but I don't know how this has been done in the past.
Based on what we found in previous reports included in the binders, we have not observed supplemental reports or supplements to the reports added in. So I guess the comment would be we don't have a precedent for that.
And I guess I was just thinking that I'm comfortable saying, you know, that there were members of the committee who felt we should have gone further on X topic. So I think I know what those are. But you know, ultimately, I think the recommendations and the majority vote is kind of what the committee officially is saying. But
I agree with that. Let me just, I'll just talk, articulate an example, and that causes you either to be agreeable or not, and I take no offense. Clearly, there are folks who want ward representation, and obviously, we believe there was something buried down in that that we've tried to respond to. One of my points that sort of been left slipped through the cracks is I felt an obligation to leave behind some institutional memory about the ward proposal, and I was particularly pleased with Bill Shuck's report to this body. And I would say that with respect to those who still want to champion ward representation, we don't want to lose the institutional knowledge of our experience. Would they do it at the special election next time? Probably not. Would they give a formula for increasing council to 50 people? Probably not. Would they look at Bill Shuck's piece of work and say, you know, that guy sort of, he had some points there, and he did have some points there. And I'd like to see that honored in some way and not just lost here with our work. And that's something I would put in my supplemental thing, you understand. It doesn't disagree, it's supportive, but it still gives at least me a chance. And of course, anybody else could join in that, if you understand what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
And no offense intended or taken with respect to how this plays from this point on, but I think a case can be made for, in fact, letting people articulate things that resonated with them that maybe didn't make it into the full report.
I'm gonna have to defer to staff a little bit. My gut is that I don't want to include that. On the other hand, Bill's material is specifically included in the report.
It's gonna be like this.
I understand. And I'm not necessarily opposed to, we gotta think through how the preamble works, but I mean, I think there were materials like that that really gave the committee a lot to think about, and that council and other groups, I don't have a problem referencing that, I guess is what I'm saying, like in the preamble of things that, you know, there's been a lot of thought put into this work by different people, and as council looks now and in the future at what's best for our city, those are the kinds of things that should be reviewed.
I'm certain we'll find common ground on this, and there seemed to be a suggestion there in your remarks that perhaps the preamble may tag this base, and that's fine with me, but it needs to tag the base rather than just being lost in the process.
I hear what you're saying. So let's just see how this.
I was just going to add that, you know, regardless of what's outlined in the process, nothing would preclude any one of us from coming
Absolutely.
To whatever, you know,
Absolutely.
Subcommittee or full council meeting to kind of share our own views.
Absolutely.
In addition to the chair's report, or, you know,
Great.
Kind of separately. So I don't think it'll be lost one way or the other.
Thank you for that point, because I think it's a good one. Uh-huh. I think it's a good one. 3 years from now, when they turn back to this, they're going to take out our report, not what got said after the report got delivered. And so again, I try to make the case that our preamble working title be prepared to tag some of these bases out of respect for some of these comments that came to our attention in support of ward representation.
So I agree with John. I think if we looked back at one of the drafts of this, it had a little bit of that in the past. This is, you know, I mean, I think part of it is framing the story and framing the process.
Mm-hmm.
So I think, you know, to that end, you know, giving a nod in that direction as to, you know, it's really a narrative of why we came to these conclusions. And I do think that there were important points. And I think that, you know, the whole district, that whole conversation stemmed from, we understand we want to move, you know, potentially, if in the future we want to move to the ward process, if we're not quite ready to do that yet, this is where we came, this is where we landed in that. And I do think that it's important to capture that, because to John's point, I think that this committee, what I've appreciated is that we've been very thoughtful about the process, and we've been very thoughtful to think about all points and how people perceive things. And I think, you know, even to this point of, let's stop, let's talk about what this narrative is, let's talk about the story of how we got to this so that people can really understand it, I think is important to capture, because to John's point, they are gonna pull this out, they're gonna look at that, because it's the cliff notes to the whole thing, right? You're not gonna pull out that whole book.
Madam Chair, I think that, I understand what John's saying.
to me, that's part of the preamble. I mean, we're going to talk about the history. We are going to acknowledge that we are here because the issue of changing to a ward system or whatever, that should be part of it. And that we had proposals we reviewed, we considered. My concern is singling out specific proposals, because we had a number of proposals. It wasn't just Bill Shucks. There were a number, two and three times, of specific proposals. So, you know, I don't think we should pick out one when we've had three or four submit, if I remember correctly. So I think it should be included to let people know that we did consider it. We did consider the comments, and this is the result of our deliberations. That's what this report is. It's after all consideration of all information, this is what we are recommending. And I think how to do that. I'm just reluctant to single out one report when there were others, because I think that puts us in a different.
Here's what I think we're gonna do. We're gonna go with the plan that we said. I don't anticipate wanting to add sort of supplemental or individual reports, but let's see how next week plays out. And I'm not totally opposed if ultimately you or someone else feels like there needs to be something specifically included that hasn't been, but let's let them work their magic with words and see what that looks like. Because I also don't want to dilute the fact that we are making some recommendations that, and for that matter, that we're making some substantial recommendations that are pretty significant to the city if council were to take our recommendations. So I don't want to end up having a diluted report when we have spoken pretty clearly on a number of topics. So let's just try to get through. Let's look at what that, again, whatever it's named, preamble looks like. I think we at one point had a lot more detail in this, and some people expressed a desire not to have all that. I'm kind of hearing that we want more of that back, so we may need to go find some of your old drafts.
I think we wanted more stuff, just not specifically that stuff.
Okay, got it. She wants more stuff, not that stuff.
Well, my specific concern was all that history suggested that was material to our determination, and I thought that was not what we wanted to say. But I think we're saying we want more stuff on the backside, that here are some things we considered, and pay some respect to the
other
points.
That we considered those things.
I got you. You guys got it? Okay, great. You do, right? I was just gonna say, there's a recording of this. If you don't know what we're talking about, maybe the video will help. All right, so the plan is, again, staff will send us information by the 14th. It will also be put on the web that comment deadline is the 14th. If there's any additional public comments, they'll submit them to us by the 14th. Any feedback staff would like by noon on the 16th, and we will meet on the 17th in person. Just to clarify, is that gonna be at 1 or could it be later? I would prefer 3. Does anyone have an issue with 3?
What time did we originally set?
1. That's what?
Friday.
I know.
Oh, pardon me.
See, I work 45 minutes away, so I kill a whole day. So.
Feedback by the 16th and then publish on the 17th?
No, we're meeting on the 17th.
All right. Well, feedback by when?
Noon on the 16th.
16th, and we're meeting on the 17th?
Yes.
And that's presumably when we publish our report?
No, on the 17th, that would be like we're all going to sit here and make sure we agree to a final report. Hopefully not a long meeting. And at the end of that discussion, they would know what the binder should look like to hand the city staff.
That's a pretty short period of time.
We'll see how it goes.
Well, I just think about, we don't know what we're gonna lob at them on the 16th.
I understand.
And maybe it's not fair.
Well, and let me clarify. If what you see on the 16th is not, we should not have a meeting on the 17th, then you need to cancel it and we'll reschedule it.
God bless you.
So we're looking at maybe
we will do our best.
So the 17th, can we make it a little later than 1? Does anyone have an objection? When I said 3, I saw panic, so how about 2? Everyone okay with 2? Gary?
Yes.
2?
I just have kid pickups, but I can work something out.
Okay, fantastic, thank you. 2 p.m. on the 17th. All right.
2 p.m.
Okay. I move to adjourn. Is there a second?
There is a second.
Carrie, thank you. All those in favor? Aye. Thank you, Mr. Mills.
Bye, Fred.
Are there wine and chocolates?
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. You too.